They supplied the food. They supplied the garment. They supplied everything that you need to survive. My king, when I made that walk to the altar, from that day on, he supplied all of my needs. He didn't play around. And then what? So when he went into that, he asked that guy, said, what is going on? I've already tried. I supplied all your needs and you're still not living up to par. See, the God I knows, he can get on your tail sometime. And then, you know, sometimes it takes just a little tap on the shoulder and say, hey, you know, you need to move on. Have you ever been in a beach and you have your lawn chair and you sit there too long and then the thing continues to sink? If you don't get up and move around, you're going to sink. You're going to sink. I sat in the chair one time for about a day, it seemed like, and before I left that weekend, the butt of the chair was all the way down in the sand. That's the evidence of some of our lives. We don't get up and move around. We gotta get out of these pews. We gotta do work. You see, it's not enough just to walk the aisle. We gotta do work. See, that man made a half-hearted effort. He wasn't living up to the standards that God has called us to be. And we all don't have to make over $100,000 a year to live up these standards. But these standards are getting on your knees. These standards are getting to your word, brother. These standards are being an example to your children, to your grandchildren. These standards are answering the call. There's a call that we all have to answer. And sometimes we get lackluster. We start living off of grace instead of living in grace. See, being part of God's kingdom means we have to be diligent in the effort to live up to these standards. We have to be diligent. We can say one thing and do one thing. There was a big push for my friend of mine named Trey Nine. It's a big push for the Houston rapper, for the secular Houston rappers. We come to the point that they're not going to change their music. They're not going to change it. We've asked them to change it. And we have good relationships with these guys. We've asked them to change it, but they're not going to change the music. But what we did ask, and we went back and said, okay, what can we do? What can we do? So we can ask them when they're not on their CDs to come back to the children and says, look, this is not who I am. I live in the suburbs. I'm not rolling around in the hood. I'm not doing drive-bys. That this is a character that I'm playing. Right? Because movie stars can play character after character after character, but our people in our music, these young people, are looking at their lives and trying to be like them. But this movie star, he can be five different characters, and our young people don't try to be like them. So we've asked them to set a standard. If you're not going to do something, let's quit killing our young people. Let's let them know that that's just a character that you're playing. Live up to a standard, some type of standard. I like to call it spiritual sloppiness. There's too much spiritual sloppiness in the church. See, a lot of y'all, when y'all get up, there's a water puddle around y'all where y'all just sloppy. There's little pieces of paper where you got fidgety and you couldn't listen to pastor preach all night and you just tore up paper and you left it in the pews. There's too much spiritual sloppiness in the church today. We got to get a hold of God. You know what? I remember when I was growing up, hellfire and brimstone and demons and stuff, and I was scared out of my mind, but it kept me straight. Tell you, I remember demons being thrown out at the altars, and I was hiding under the pews, bumping my head on them wooden pews across the street. Because there was a standard in the church. Now we got people walking in the front door, picking up a laptop and walking out because there's no standards in the church anymore. And I think that was probably the biggest struggle that I had becoming the youth pastor. Because I seen God one way. I don't see God as a God that we can shape and we can bend and we can mold to our lives. My God shapes me and molds me to his life, to his standard. See, the spiritual sloppiness didn't work at the king's table. He was called out. And I think I might be preaching to the wrong crowd, but there might be a few of y'all here. A few of us need to be called out. My wife calls me out when I get sloppy. When I don't take my cup to the... She was talking... I'm gonna be honest. She was telling me that I need to take my stuff off the nightstand right before we got here. And I'm gonna be honest, it's still sitting there. She said, I'm tired of picking up after you. I said, you ain't picking up after me. It's still sitting there. She said, what happened to you being sweet? Oh, hallelujah. We're going to keep on moving. Yeah. Romans 6, it says, talking about God's grace. Oh, God's grace is not a gift, but it's a responsibility. It's a responsibility. We wonder why we're not effective. We wonder why we're not effective. Is our God any weaker? The only thing that makes our God weak is us. The only thing that makes God weak is us, because our God ain't weak. Our God is the same as this king. Hey, if you ain't going to act right, he's going to come through your city. He's going to tear it up. He might not do it with fire these days, but you know what? He's going to let that sin infiltrate your city. He's going to let the sin infiltrate your schools, and then your kids are going to begin to have problems because we're not holding a standard, because we're not using grace as a responsibility. We're living off on it like a loaf of bread. It says, then will, shall we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of his wonderful grace? Of course not. Since we have died to sin, how can we live in it? Now, this is the problem I have. Can I just get real with you real quick? You call yourself Christians, but you're still living in the same sin you was 3 years ago? And I ain't trying to get on this whole it's saved, always saved, and this saved, and that saved, and all these different types of saved. But come on, there's evidence in your life as you're saved. If you're still wallowing in the same sin that you was when you first got saved, then, man, you need to get somewhere and get under somebody and listen. This is the problem. Nobody wants to sit under anybody anymore. I take value in the people that came before me. There's no value anymore in the elder. There's no value anymore in somebody that you can sit under and listen to. There's none. You know, there was a rules among thieves. Not anymore. There used to be rules among thieves. You know, you don't mess with children. You leave the old people alone. Now you hear on the news that these young guys are going in and busting door down and shooting old people. Come on, she's 85 years old. Why did you have to do that? Take what you want and leave. Why? Because there's no standards. A man cannot continue to live in that sin. We must be clothed in purity. I have a message that's called Purity, and it talks about, I picked up this can off this, I think it was some apple juice or pineapple juice, and it said 100% pineapple juice. And I flipped it over to the ingredients and had pineapple juice and a bunch of other stuff. How can it be 100% pineapple juice if it has all that other stuff in it? I think that's us as Christians sometimes. We say that we're pure and we put on this front and this persona that we are and who we are and who we want everybody else to. You know, I had two of my boys, they were acting out a little bit. I said, tell me who you are. I quit playing games with me. Are you this guy that's going to act out in school, or are you the one that acts in front of me? Just let me know who you're going to be. Because if that's the one you want to be, that's the way I'm going to treat you. But if you're going to do you want to be treated like the young man that you act in front of me? That's the way I'm going to treat you. Quit playing games. Just quit playing games with God. I think that's why the church is the way it is, because we play games with God. See, there's not enough water in the world. You can be baptized. We can open this thing and keep it warm every day of the week, and we can baptize you every day of the week. But there's not enough water in the world to baptize the inside of your heart. That heart has to change. That heart has to change. Got a little story I want to just speak on before I close. I read it this past week, and it was about this family, Christian family. And the father was a typical workaholic. Worked 70, 80 hours a week at work, and then when he came home, he was in his office working. And the mother was just a beautiful Christian woman that took care of the family. And she made sure they was in church. She made sure they did well in school, and she did very good at it. She graduated her first daughter, and her son did very well throughout school until his junior and senior year, and then began to have some trouble with him. And like any good parent, she took the advice of her pastor and took him to some counseling. And as the therapist began to counsel this young man, she wanted to talk to the daughter. So the daughter came home from college and sat through the counseling. And the mother said, well, while I'm here, I might as well go through some counseling myself, because through the time of the father being gone at work, the marriage began to be rocky. And something like KK said, if there's not a relationship there, there's probably not a true relationship, something that you build on. And they all begin to speak about the same thing, about how the absence of their father was the reason that they was having the issues that they had. So the therapist began to encourage them to bring the father in for family therapy. And they began to beg the father. The wife turned into a nag about getting him there. And husbands, if you have a nag at home, nags are not born, they're made. I'm just telling you right now, if your wife's a nag, it's probably because you ain't doing what you're supposed to do. Get off the couch. Get you a DVR. That's what worked for my marriage. Pastor preached a message one time about you got to get their attention. Now just push pause and she's got all my attention. But the wife began to nag the father, and then the children began to go. And after a couple of weeks, he decided to go. And the daughter was in college. She decided that she was going to be the one to confront her father, since she didn't have to live there any longer. And she began to tell her father that, you know, how come you didn't come to my softball games when I was in elementary? And when I got the lead role in the play when I was in junior high, how come you didn't come? And when I was going to be sent off to my prom in high school, how come you didn't come? She said, I knew at that point that you would never be there for me. And she said, even though that you said you wasn't come, I always looked for you. And as this young lady began to talk, the father just kept getting angry. You could see it in his eyes. And then he belted, okay, that's enough. It's enough. I'm sorry. Isn't sorry enough? And the young girl looked at her father. She said, wait a minute. I've already forgiven you. That's how I dealt with the pain and the hurt throughout my childhood. But she said, I feel sorry for you. You're the one that didn't get to know me. You're the one that didn't get to know my brother. You're the one that didn't get to see me grow up and build this relationship with me. And as I begin to read that story, begin to remind me, maybe that's how God feels. God was thinking, look, I'm sorry you didn't get to build this relationship with me. You didn't get to know who me, everything that I have for you. I have this perfect plan in my life for you. And you were too busy. You had too much stuff going on. You was chasing a career. You was chasing a status in school. But what about me? You know, I think so many times that we want certain things out of certain people, but we don't make the time. We have to make the time for the one who gave it all. We have to understand that it's critical that we answer the RSVP from our Lord. That we know that it's for everybody. That it's for everybody.